For now, it's the 25th, and that means here at CNBC TV 18, we are celebrating Prosperity Day in association with National Stock Exchange. Rahul Singh, CIO Equities of Tata Mutual Fund, now joins us. Rahul, hi. Good morning. Thanks a lot for joining us. It's been a bit treacherous, this market, over the last 1 month. You reckon it's a good time to perhaps start, you know, building some portfolios all over again?
Yes, hi, good morning. I think it's been a good time, last 3 or 4 months, to do that. Why only just 1 month? And I think the good part is that the earnings recovery in FY20 seems to be on the cards in terms of I'm talking of the broad index level earnings. Obviously, some of it is optical because the way some of the index constituents are moving from loss to profits or low profits to respectable profits. But that's a support to the valuations, I think, not entirely, but at least to some extent that's support to the valuation. So I think when the index constituents and the driver of earnings for index, which so far has been something else and is going to change in the next 12 to 15 months, it gives an opportunity to reposition the portfolios and try and make make positive alpha from some of these sectors.
Rahul, good morning. Good to have you with us, especially because on the 20th every month we celebrate this Prosperity Day along with the NSE. I wanted to ask you about the kinds of prosperity packages that may be announced tomorrow on the occasion of Republic Day, or it most certainly could be announced along with the vote on account. What's your approach to the issue if there is, say, a 1 lakh crore or a 2 lakh crore farm package?
Well, I think that is something which the market seems to be expecting, and it's almost becoming a consensus view. I think what we'll have to look at is, beyond the big announcements, what kind of the existing subsidies get subsumed into that kind of the big bang announcement which can happen. And I think that is going to be critical in deciding which way the fiscal deficit swings. My own sense is that even if there is a slippage from the current target of 3.3% in fiscal 19, I think there are enough levers for the government to manage the headline number and the slippages not to be too much. So that is from an impact on the macro and the rates, etc. I think most of that is in the price, seems to be in the price. As far as the impact on sectors and stocks are concerned, I think any boost to the farm side of economy obviously will be taken positively for the consumption space, and within consumption the staples and FMCG, which frankly at the kind of valuations which they are trading at, I don't know whether it will matter that much, but still something which will sustain, could sustain the valuations for a little bit longer. Interestingly, if we did an analysis of the last 2 or 3 elections and 6 months prior to elections, there's not been too much visible impact of any agri boost or any boost to the farm incomes on the consumption, really. And I'm talking about the consumption which you typically associate with the rural side of the economy. So the evidence is weak, but I think from a sentiment point of view, it will be important.
Okay, by the way, just keep an eye out on a couple of result reactions. Pfizer is now up almost 6% post its numbers, so the street definitely likes that one. And on the downside, it's Emphasis, where there is pressure on the margins, and that's something that the street is sort of punishing. That stock is under pressure now. Rahul, hi, good morning. For the private sector banks, it's like, you know, private banks 2.0, a new helm, a new normal, a lot of, in management changes at Yes Bank, ICICI Bank, Axis Bank, etc. Is this the time to be putting fresh money to work here?
I think one leg of the move is over, and I think the market has been talking about this move, and finally it has come and it's sustaining at these levels. So I think you could spend some time consolidating at these levels. But I think the part of the private bank kind of thesis which is well understood and kind of well anticipated now is obviously the
the credit side or the credit cost side, where we are building in lower and lower credit costs. But I think on the top line, or what I call as the net interest margin or the NII side, also there is sufficient momentum in terms of credit growth, pricing power, market share gains. So therefore, I think private sector banks as a whole, and not just the corporate lenders, are something which are going to do well this year. And we are not only talking about the corporate lenders here, but we are talking about banks with good CASA, good retail franchise, as well as the pricing power, which is now returned. And you can see it in some of the results which have been announced, that the NIMs have held on or marginally moved up, even for the larger banks.
Okay. By the way, just a couple of other stocks. Biocon is now at the low point of the day, and once again boils down to the market positioning. There was so many long positions in Biocon, now that stock is slipping. And yesterday we made this point about KPIT Tech when it opened, that the fair value is somewhere around 115. Mm. The stock could do anything yesterday because it was the first day. It already slipped quite a bit yesterday and now has moved to that fair value. So, it's always important to look at what the price earnings of that stock would be once the new business list. And that one slowly but surely gravitating towards its fair value. It was around 144 yesterday. Fair value is 115 or thereabout. Rahul, your thoughts on IT? We have seen TCS do well. Of course, not perhaps this year, but last year was a good one. Infosys has been a bit of a leadership stock for the market. Midcap IT has done well. How are you approaching this pocket?
I think IT is in a neutral zone. We are seeing reasonable amount of traction on the earnings and deal wins as of now, which means fiscal 20 earnings, we are looking at pretty decent mid-teens kind of earnings growth rate, at least for a lot of these companies, which is a good thing because you're getting those earnings with certainty and with valuations which are again now back in mid-teens or high teens. So suddenly, compared to the market, IT is not looking as badly placed as it was probably 3-4 months back when valuations were running away. What we need to watch is there, obviously, the impact of any worsening of the global slowdown trends which we are seeing, and what impact it has on the capital spending patterns of the corporates on IT. And therefore, what we need to watch is the deal wins. Right now, the deal pipeline and deal momentum is pretty strong. So I think from owning large caps, I think the risk reward is moderately favorable. It's not hugely favorable because the valuation move last year has been pretty phenomenal. But if I compare it with the rest of the market, the valuations still offer a reasonably decent risk reward, at least among the large caps, which will be less impacted even if there were to be a sharp slowdown. The large caps would withstand that better than the mid caps, which some of which are now trading at not a very big discount to the large caps.
Okay, what's your pecking order now in terms of sectoral preference? Is it export oriented or is it domestic oriented?
Difficult to generalize like that, because within domestic oriented there are some segments which are showing green shoots, and we are quite positive from a 2 to 3 year perspective on the capex cycle, for example. At the same time, consumption, given the way the valuations are, some of the interim slowdown which we are seeing on the auto side, one needs to be cautious and maybe very, very stock specific in that space. In the export side, again, it's the same story. We look at the IT services we just spoke about. On pharma, it's again a mixed bag. The generic pricing environment has improved a bit, but still a long way to go before one can call it a bottom. There have been other issues in the pharma sector as well. So therefore, it's sector by sector rather than export versus domestic, really.
All right. FMCG, while I take your point that, auto consumption, consumer discretionaries have suffered, the FMCG sector seems to have done well. I mean, Hindustan Unilever volumes, Colgate volumes have not disappointed. Over there, is there a price discomfort, or would you go with FMCG rather than discretionary?
Well, we are overweight on consumption in our funds, so that is a space which we like. What we need to remember though in consumption is that one, there is obviously, as you said, in the FMCG staple space, I think the rural side of the market has phenomenally surprised in terms of the volume growth. It could probably sustain, at least in terms of sentiment, and if not in terms of evidence, like I said earlier, till we move into elections. And also, one has to realize that the consumption space, especially the FMCG space, we are also looking at these valuations because of lack of alternatives or the lack of alternative sectors which are showing similar momentum. So it's a bit of a lack of alternatives which is also leading to this situation. And till the time we don't move decisively away into a phase where other parts of the economy and other parts of the market start to do significantly better, you cannot rule out FMCG as a sector despite the high valuations. But within that also, one has to be, as I said, one has to be more selective now given the valuations and given the different dynamics which each of these companies have.
All right, Rahul, we'll leave it at that. Thanks so much for joining us and giving us your thoughts. By the way, 10 points out of the Nifty 76 points is coming in from Reliance Industries.